So we had a change in the program, and instead of Professor Cabré, instead of Professor Vasquez now, who was supposed to talk now, we have Professor Valdinoci with the second lecture. So, Enrico.
So I'm glad that so many people came to see Xavi and Juan Luis. They have to be satisfied with me. It's also very nice to be after Juan Luis because I can use many of the ideas that he introduced. So I will be able to use extension methods and the idea that somehow fractional models correspond to power law decays and things like this. And also I will use the idea that fractional models have to deal with important things coming from real life. So one thing that I have to correct from Juan Luis' lecture is that, of course, Real Madrid is only the second best team in the world, and the first is, of course, Roma. As you see, the most important... Cosa? But the most important things of these days is what happened in Stadio Olimpico yesterday, and to explain a little bit of this, what I did is the following. I think it's kind of an instructive computation if you want to study fractional problems. This is taken from Wikipedia, and season by season you have the number of goals scored by Totti, which is a huge number. What I did, I took the difference of goals from one season to the next one, and I averaged this number 2 years in advance and 2 years after, and I plot this in a graph. So I don't know if... Okay. So basically, what you have in the vertical direction is the frequency on how much this number occurred. So you expect that a player scores the same number of goals more or less in average as the previous years. So you expect that zero occurs with a large frequency. But you have cases in which from 1 year to the other, you have a big difference of goals scored, either with a positive sign or with a negative sign, okay? And so the red dots are the frequency of these occurrences. For instance, in average, with the plus or minus 2 years average, Totti scored the same number of goals of the previous year 8 times. Okay? And then what I did, I computed the average and the standard deviations of these points, and I plotted the Gaussian with this average and standard deviation. And the result is terrible because the blue curve doesn't look like, but this is a Gaussian, and it's a Gaussian because whenever you have ugly oscillations and long tail at infinity, your Gaussian will tend to be very flat and close to zero, because what is a Gaussian after all? A Gaussian is a constant times a negative exponential, okay? Minus sigma. Okay, so whenever you need the Gaussian to be very flat at infinity and to have a long tail, the best you can do is to make this sigma very small, but this means that this is almost constant, and then to keep the volume equal to 1, the big C will be actually very small, and so the picture that you get is a Gaussian with a very small constant in front and a very small sigma, which is almost a small constant. And so it's not good to model something like this. But then you can remember that you know fractional Laplacian, And you can do this. You can put... so let me say that I will call x the horizontal variable and y the vertical variable. And then I can put these plots in a log-log frame. So I will call big Y to be the log of Y and big X to be the log of X. Now, as a technical remark, the reason for which I averaged the number of goals with plus or minus 2 years is because I wanted to have positive X and Ys and not to deal with the log of zero, something like this. Well, if I do that, what I get is the following. So these are the dots in the big X and big Y variables. And the blue line is the Gaussian in these variables, still pretty bad. But so instead of this, this is the same picture of the red dots in the log-log frame. But now I do something a little bit smarter. So I try to put a straight line, the blue line, as close as I can to these plots. Again, this is not a very professional job. I did it by hands. But then let's see what happens if I plot back the original X and Y variables. Well, now the agreement looks much better. So it's not perfect. You see there is still some dots here and there. But if you compare with what happens before, it's a huge improvement. And this is a power tail distribution in the sense of Juan Luis, where roughly speaking, because in the log-log plot, I was putting a straight line. So a straight line is y equal to a constant. Was a straight line which actually decreased in direction. So there was a minus, well, some coefficient m times x. If you scale in the original variable, and let me call big C like the log of small c, you have log y equal to log c minus m log x. Which is the log of c over x to the m, and so it's like y equals c over x to the m. Okay. Now, I promised to do some of the proofs of the claim of this morning only using pictures. So I will only prove this in a very specific case, because by picture you cannot do everything, of course. But I think they will kind of convincing. So for this, I will use a couple of information. One thing is that one knows what the square root of a complex number is. So I will use this notation. If I take a complex number z to be rho e to the I theta, I will define the square root of z to be the square root of rho e to the I theta over 2. Now, to avoid multiplicity problems, I will restrict the argument theta to be between minus pi. And this is a plot of the real part of the square root under this this notation. And as you see, you have some problems here when theta is equal to pi. And it must be that. And this is the plot of the imaginary part. And you see here that when you do a circle, you have a 2 pi difference from one piece of the surface to the other, as it should be from the expression there. If you put instead of theta plus 2 pi, you get a pi here, which gives you the discontinuity. Okay, why we care about the square root? Well, we do care about the square root because this morning we made a very funny claim, which was this, that if you have US of x to be 1 minus x squared to the s plus, and then you take the fractional Laplacian of US, this is equal to a constant. And probably I should have emphasized more this morning because some people asked me. I have the inclination to forget about constants. All the constants sooner or later will become one. And even in definition of the fractional Laplacian, I didn't put any constant. But if you want to be consistent, for instance, with the Fourier approach, you have to put the right constants to do things in the correct ways. And this was very strange for us because you have a picture like this. Actually, equal to 1. Because this looks like concave here, so you have a minus sign should be 1. Okay, and this was very strange because it was producing a boundary behavior which was not the same as the classical case. And another thing that it was producing somehow, so this in B1. Another thing that was producing that was somehow strange is that if you fix this point here and you make a blow-up picture, then you have this situation that I was calling Vs of x, which is take, for instance, the last coordinate, the positive part to the power s, then Vs is harmonic in the Hall space. I mean, somehow, if you believe in the first, you believe in the second, because when you blow up your picture, I mean, you scale US like in US of X over R, and you do this. When you make the scaling, the 1 will go to a power of R, and sending R to 0, you kill the nonlinearity, you kill the right-hand side, and you go to 0. And this, again, was very strange because of several reasons. The first is geometric, because we have a strange object. We have something which is zero here, and then it grows like a cusp to infinity. And this doesn't really seem natural to think that this object is harmonic, but it is in the fractional sense. And the other, at least for me, the first time I saw this thing was a computational objection. So somehow, if I take the fractional Laplacian of order s, is an object which makes 2s derivatives. So if I make 2s derivative of an s power, I should get a minus s power. So the first time I saw a picture like this or a formula like that, I said to myself, there is for sure a mistake, because there is no geometric reason for which this picture is true. And there is an obvious analytic reason for which if I take the fractional Laplacian of this object, well, this should be not zero, should be a constant. times xn to the power minus s. So let's discuss a bit whether or not the picture is correct and whether or not the analysis is correct. So first of all, if you think about the picture is correct, you can find these heuristic explanations and also some rigorous proofs in a small book I wrote with Claudia Bucur. Is a Springer lecture note of the Unione Matematica Italiana. And so let me give a heuristic argument that convinces us that this picture should be correct, which is somehow this. Let's consider, for instance, an interval here, and let's try to understand what is the S-harmonic function with this data outside. So if we are in the classical setting, starting from this point and arriving to this point, the natural thing to do in the harmonic case, in the classical harmonic case, would just to take a straight segment joining these two points. And as Juan Luis taught us, there is a probabilistic reason for this, because we can see this data as the payoff that we obtain if we follow a random walk back and forward, and what is the expected payoff that we expect starting from here is exactly the average value between this point and this point, which is the point in the middle. So for instance, suppose that this is 0 and this is 1, well, this point here is the average between 0 and 1, which is 1/4, which is 1/2, okay? And then you can do the same starting from the point 1/4, and you say, what is the expected payoff starting from here? Well, I can either drift to this point and reach 0, or drift to this point and reach an expected value of 1/2. So the average of the two is 0 plus 1/2 divided by 2, which is 1/4, okay? And so you get 1/4 and so on. So this is a complicated proof, if you like, that the straight segment is harmonic in the classical sense. But it's an instructive proof because let's try to do the same argument in a local case. Then we see this, that if I start from 1/2, then I can follow the process and say exit to the right or to the left. If I exit to the left, I always get 0. If I exit to the right, I can get 1, or I can get something bigger than 1. So this is very good because somehow it tells me that my expected payoff is not the average between 0 and 1. But it's a weighted average between the values on the left, which are always 0, and the values on the right, which are always bigger than 1. So the value that I have to get here is actually bigger than the straight line. So I take something here. And similarly, if I do now the straight line joining this value with this value, and I repeat the argument here, well, if I start from 1/4, I can maybe drift and get 0 to the left, or drift towards the right and get a payoff, which is in fact bigger than the payoff that I have here. So I can get this value, or I can get something more. And so the value that I have here for my S-harmonic function must be above this segment, and so on. So now probably the picture gets a little bit spoiled if I keep going, but what I wanted to say is that whenever I find a value and I make a segment joining with the origin, the picture that I have is always to be above this segment. And so this is a kind of natural concavity that my S-harmonic function needs to have near the origin. Okay, still, the analysis plays against us because it tells us that if I take two S derivatives of an S power, I should get a minus S power. So what's wrong with that? And this is a little bit more tricky, because the answer is that there is nothing wrong with that. For instance, if we apply this formula on the negative values of x, that's exactly what we get. We get a constant times x to the minus s. The very strange thing is that if we apply this formula on the right-hand side of the on the positive x, then the constant that we get is equal to zero. So, for instance, if you want a proof of this in this line, that is the idea of computing this constant by the integrals, the singular integral defining the fractional Laplacian, can be computed explicitly. It's not completely trivial. One has to integrate by parts a couple of times. But if one does that, can compute this constant and check that this constant is magically zero. And for instance, this proof is contained in this booklet, if you want to look at it. But today I promised no computations, just picture. So I will do the proof of this formula in dimension one. And for s equal 1/2. And I have to admit that this is the only proof I know of this fact based only on pictures. Well, based only on pictures and on the formula that Juan Luis pointed out, that is the idea of the extension. So somehow, the idea of the extension is that you have a function small u that produces a function that I will call big U of x and y. So since I'm doing picture, for me, x will be in R, and xy will be in R times 0 infinity. And this big U is the harmonic extension of small u. So somehow, big U solves Laplace of U equal to zero. With big U of X zero equal to U of X. And then I can reconstruct the fractional Laplacian. Of U by taking the y derivative of big U and evaluating it at zero. Okay. Now there is a little trick in this definition. This definition is not perfect as it is because, in a sense, the harmonic extension is not unique. Because if I have u that solves this equation, I can always sum a constant times y, and it solves the same equation. A constant times y vanishes when y is equal to zero, and it's harmonic. So in this, I also have to follow Juan Luis' advice, forget a bit the functional spaces and just rely on intuition. I have to choose, so whenever I choose a harmonic extension, I am forced to choose the representation of this harmonic extension that has the best possible decay at infinity. Okay, so we will always keep in mind that whenever I draw a picture of a harmonic extension, it better grows as much as possible at infinity. So if I do that, the approach for this, so now I want to prove this formula just basically using pictures. And the idea is that I have to find the harmonic extension for the square root of 1 minus x squared. So the natural thing to do is to say, okay, I know the complex square root, and I know that if I take the real part of a holomorphic function, I get a harmonic function. So the natural thing to do would be, well, why not looking at u1 half of xy to be the real part of the square root of 1 minus z squared. Okay, that could be a good idea. The only drawback of this is that if I take z of the form iy and y large, the square root of 1 minus z square is equal to 1 minus I square, which is minus 1, which becomes plus y square. So it goes like y at infinity. So this is very bad. So the only way I can make this as a good candidate with decay at infinity is to subtract the y. Okay? Or if you prefer, it's clear, right? I have to subtract the y. I mean, if you want to write it as a real part of a holomorphic function, this is just the real part of, so I have to put what? I z, if I put iz, okay. As promised, this is the picture. So as you see, this is exactly the function big U here. You can see this is the profile at y equal to 0, which is exactly my half circumference. And this is the decay at infinity. Well, with this I'm done, because if I want to compute the fractional Laplacian of small u, I will just take the y derivative of big U and take y equal to 0. Now, this guy is quadratic, and you can check that it gives no contribution. Well, this guy is actually minus y. When I take the derivative, I get minus 1, but I have a minus sign here, so I get 1. Okay, so if you are convinced that this is a proof, we can do an even more fancy thing. Since we learned our method, the other thing I claim today is that if you put a minus 1/2, so if instead of u 1/2, you look at u minus 1/2, in the sense that we put minus 1/2 here and 0 outside, there is a minus 1/2 here. I don't know if it's readable from far. I change 1/2 to minus 1/2. So now the picture is much more dramatic. Because the function has now a shape like this. But quite surprisingly, The fractional Laplacian of this function is zero. Now, I'm happy that also Francesco is surprised by this thing. So when Nicola Battangelo told me this, I said, no, come on, it's not possible. It looks quite surprisingly, but it's true. And actually, if we learned our method, now it's kind of easy to do it, because I can just make a minor modification on the blackboard. I want to look now for the harmonic extension of u minus 1 half, which will be called big U minus 1 half. Well, what can I do? Well, I knew from the previous example that it's a good idea to look at 1 over the square root of 1 minus z squared. Now, in this case, I don't have to subtract anything at infinity, because this thing is always decaying, so it helps me this time. I don't have to do anything. The only thing is maybe to look at the picture, and the picture is that one. Now, the problem of pictures is that sometimes the computer is not intelligent and does not put the picture where I want, so of course, this part here, that is the part going to infinity, is somehow the most nice thing of the picture, but the computer cuts the picture at level 2. But it's kind of, I mean, you can see that this is growing to infinity somehow. Yeah. So it seems to me like the dome of a circus, right? You have two peaks here and the dome of the circus like this. And so the trace is this function blowing up that I drew there. It goes, it's going to zero at infinity. And if I do this now, so if I do the case with minus 1 half, well, as I was saying, you believed me before that this was quadratic and it was producing a zero, so this is just producing a zero. Okay, so for next picture, probably I have to discuss a bit the last difference that I didn't have time to deal with this morning, which was somehow already highlighted by Juan Luis in his lecture. So at some point, Juan Luis complained, saying, you said that you had 8 differences, but 8 is not a very nice number. And so I thought a bit and I said, well, but the last difference is actually made of 3 differences, because, and so that would make 10 if you count it like this. So the difference 8 for me was the decay at infinity. We will see 3 types of differences, because this morning I said, okay, I will do this 3 times, 1 for the Schrödinger equation, one for the Allen-Kahn equation, and then I said, and I don't remember the other, but then I remembered what was the third one, when Juan Luis said, speaking about the heat flow, we should include this as a new difference, and in fact that was the other one, so the fundamental, the heat kernel, that was supposed to be the third one, the solution of the fractional heat equation. So let me start with this. So let's discuss what is a fractional heat kernel. Well, in the classical case, you can decide that you study the heat equation like dtu minus the fraction Laplacian of u equal to zero, say in Rn times u infinity or whatever, and suppose that you prescribe u at time zero to be the delta of zero. So all your heat is concentrated at the origin and you diffuse it. And you see what happens. Then in the classical case, as Juan Luis says, the real thing that you have to learn in mathematics is that the solution is a Gaussian, right? You said something like this in the lecture. So u of x, okay. And since I will mess up the scaling, I compute what happens at time one. Everything is invariant under space-time scaling. But since I'm quite sure that I will put the t in the wrong place, I scale the time to be one, and I get up to constants the Gaussian. And so I will call this g of x. Of course, I can do the same game in the fractional case. So the fractional case would be just instead of the Laplacian, put the fractional Laplacian and find what you can call GS of x. Again, you can call the solution of this equation at time one. And the question is how this GS looks like. There is an easy answer. The answer is take Fourier transform of it. If you take Fourier transform, you have that the derivative of the Fourier transform of u is equal to minus xi to the 2s u hat, forgetting constants. And this says that, u hat is the anti-Fourier transform of e to the minus psi to the 2s. Sorry, u is the anti-Fourier transform. Okay? U hat is e to the minus, and then u anti-Fourier transform, right? This is a good answer, though a not very good answer, in the sense that it's absolutely not evident from this expression that you have a nice object to deal with. It can be proved, as Juan Luis mentioned, that u goes like 1 plus, that g, so again, say gx, gs, is going like a power at infinity. So at infinity, you have this heat kernel that still decays to zero, but in a much, much slower way than the classical case. The classical case was a Gaussian, so the exponential of a quadratic function. Here you only decay like n plus 2s. I don't have a simple proof of this for any s, but there are simple proofs for s equal 1/2. For s equal 1/2, there are several proofs that one can do. This would be just the anti-Fourier transform of e to the minus x. And The first proof is historical, so the things have a name. This guy is called Abel Kernel. And the Fourier transform of the Abel kernel is the Poisson kernel. But this is just because one knows the references. It's not really a proof. It's just a name, okay? The fact is that if n is equal to 1, then one can just compute the integrals. N equal to 1 is much easier in this case because the norm of x is just the absolute value. So if I write down the definition of Fourier transform, I can integrate and say the mod of x is minus x for negative x, x for positive x, and compute the integrals of the exponentials, and I get what I want. So this I leave to you as an exercise. Again, if you don't manage to do it, let's chat about it. But this exercise, I would say, is much simpler than the one I gave this morning about the master equation, okay? This is really an exercise that if you sit down 5 minutes, probably you do it just computing the integrals of the exponentials. When n is bigger or equal than 2, the situation is a little bit more tricky. I have a proof using computing integrals, but it's not nice. So I have it somewhere, and it takes some pages, but above all, it's not very instructive because it only uses clever tricks of integration. So I will just show you. It takes a little bit more than a page. And if you see it from far, it's not very instructive. I mean, it's just full of integrals. And you integrate cleverly by parts 3 or 4 times. You use one Lewis trick to remember that the Gaussian is the Fourier transform of itself. And by magic, it works. But there is a nicer approach that is valid in any dimension, and it's basically based on this picture. The picture is only two-dimensional because of the limits of the whiteboard, but the argument is actually, it works in any dimension. And it's based on the idea somehow that when you look at the extension, the variable y can play the role of a translation with respect to time. So or if you want, if you are more advanced from a PD perspective, the fact is that the Poisson kernel is the normal derivative of the fundamental solution. And so you just have to put your fundamental solution in the extended space, a little bit far from trace, and to take derivatives. We will be more clear now. So the idea is that you write your fundamental solution, let me call gamma of x, to be, well, so for me, gamma is the fundamental solution in R n plus 1. So the fundamental solution is 1 over x to the n minus 2. But if n is n plus 1, the fundamental solution is 1 over x to the n minus 1. If n plus 1 is bigger or equal than 2, which means No, if n, it be greater than 3, if n is bigger or equal than 2, and the log the minus, I think. So if I do this, I also consider u of x, y, and t to be the derivative of gamma in y plus t. As I was saying, I look at the fundamental solution, I translate it, and I make a derivative. So somehow I use y and t as interchangeable parameters. But now I have a nice computation, because you can compute the derivative of y of gamma. Well, this is just a simple computation. In both cases, you get y plus t divided by x squared plus y plus t squared to the n plus 1 over 2. Okay, which means that your u, big u of x0 t, is actually the function that we were calling g1 half, well, x0 1 is g1 half. G1 half. Right, we were calling G1 half exactly 1 over x squared plus t squared to the n plus 1 over 2. I think I wrote it here, but I erased it at some point. But that was the Gauss kernel, the fractional heat kernel. Now, the fact is that we have to prove that the fractional heat kernel in this way satisfies the fractional heat equation. So for actually, here it is. It's still written on the blackboard. So just that, I have to compute how much is dTu plus the fractional Laplacian of u. Well, dTu is fine. I can compute it from here. This would be just if I take y equal to 0, would be the derivative in t of x squared plus t squared to the n plus 1 over 2. Now, this guy here will be minus the limit as y goes to 0 of the y derivative of big U. Okay? But now, the y derivative of big U is this, right? Big U is dy gamma. So if instead of big U, I put y plus t, et cetera, et cetera, I have this expression. But now you see, this is zero, because here I'm differentiating in y, here I'm differentiating in t, but y and t plays exactly the same role in the computation. So I don't even need to compute the derivative. I know, just looking at the symmetry, that this is zero. Okay, and the picture you have above is exactly the plot of big U in 2D. So the trace would be the Poisson kernel, and you have the extension as drawn. Okay, what else? This takes into account the striking difference between the decay at infinity of the heat kernel in the classical and fractional case. And then, what about the Allen-Kahn equation? So the Allen-Kahn equation even in 1D is a difficult equation in the fractional setting. So the classical Allen-Kahn equation is that minus Laplace of u is equal to u minus u cube. Probably we will talk more about this equation later on. Right now, just let me tell that it's a very important equation in many fields, and it models phase coexistence situations. And it's somehow one of the first equation in the realm of reaction diffusion that Juan Luis was talking about. And you can consider its fractional analog, that would be this, that can be considered somehow by extension method a sort of boundary reaction equation in the local setting. Well, still, you want to know what happens to the solution at infinity. Now, in the classical case, you can solve an ODE in 1D you can multiply by u and integrate, and when you do this you have an explicit solution that is exactly u of t, say, or of x if you prefer, is the hyperbolic tangent up to a constant, which is square root of 2. And now the hyperbolic tangent goes to the equilibria exponentially fast. So what happens is that for large x, well, u converges to 1, but it converges exponentially fast to 1. Okay, as you imagine, this is not true in the fractional case. Let me erase this. We have to remember that we will discuss the Schrödinger equation later on, if time allows. So in the fractional case, this is not true. You can look at this equation in 1D. Now, even in 1D, I don't have a better notation for the fractional Laplacian. I mean, the Laplacian becomes two derivatives in 1D. The fractional Laplacian, there is no simple name even in 1D. So I write it like this, even if I'm doing the analysis in 1D. And the analysis in 1D is unfortunately extremely complicated. There are two papers that deal with the analog of this object in the fractional case. One that I did with Giampiero Palatucci and Ovidio Savin, and there are two papers by Xavi Cabré and Yannick Sir. And one of the results that was found in these papers was that you have suppose that you want to find the solution of this equation, say normalized in a way that u of 0 is 0, that u is increasing, and that has limits at plus and minus infinity equal to plus and minus 1. Which would be the natural analog of this one. So this is something that looks like this. But you can still find such solution. The only thing is that U does not decay exponentially to the equilibrium, but it only decays polynomially fast. So what you have in this case is that 1 minus U goes like a constant divided by x to the 2s. Okay. Again, how can we prove this at least for s equal to 1/2 in a simple way? Well, the idea is that we can look at a slightly modified equation, which is instead of u minus u cube, let's put the sine of u. At the end, sine of u is u minus u cube at the third order. So let's look to a similar equation, or let's say s equal to 1/2. Not u minus u cube, but sine of, let me renormalize things so that I have 1 and minus 1. I put the pi just because I want 1 and minus 1 as equilibria and not the pi as equilibria. Okay. And then it turns out that there is an explicit solution of this that I write it as 2 over pi arctan of x. Now, the arctan looks similar on the graph to hyperbolic tangent, but it's structurally very different because, I mean, if I draw the picture, I will draw it the very same way. But if you are more careful, you understand that the decay at infinity of 1 minus u is only like 1 over x. So it's not exponential at all. So the two functions are structurally very different. And well, once you have this, you can either say, well, I believe that this must be the typical behavior also for this equation, or you can construct this, you can use this to construct barriers for the other equation. So you can either believe it or make a rigorous proof. But what I would like to do is to convince yourself that this is a solution of this equation. And this is not completely straightforward because, so for instance here, I said multiply by u and integrate and you get the solution. But in fact I could have said, I tell you that this is a solution, one takes two derivatives and checks. So somehow, if I write the solution in the classical case, checking that it's a solution can be boring, but it's somehow conceptually trivial because I have to take derivative and not making mistakes. Here, even if someone comes to me and say, this is the solution, well, I'm still having big trouble to check that it's a solution. So I tell you one possibility is that one looks for BU of that is 2 over pi of the arctan of x divided by 1 plus y. Well, if you think about the arctan is like the argument of a complex number, so here basically you are taking z plus I, you are taking the log, and you are taking the maybe the imaginary part of that. So if you proceed like this, you can check that this function is harmonic on the upper half plane, and when y is equal to 0, of course, it recovers this one. And the picture for this this. Now, as you see, this here is the arctangent, which in fact looks like, unfortunately, the hyperbolic tangent that I drew here, but we know it's not equal. And then it has to go to zero at infinity, so it has this funny shape that this point here is very close to one, so it has to be dragged down towards zero. This point here is very close to minus one, it has to be dragged up towards zero. So this line is almost horizontal. Well, not really, I mean, here is a little bit higher than here because we didn't reach infinity, but still, in principle, we are trying to put everything going to zero. Well, if you do so, then one can compute the y derivative of big U and check that it's exactly equal to the sine of pi U, just putting everything together. And I don't do it on the blackboard because, okay, let's say this is an exercise. And the exercise is not difficult except that you have to remember a little bit of trigonometric formulas to write the sine of the arctangent, okay? There are too many trigonometric functions somehow. When you compose the trigonometric function with an inverse trigonometric function, you have simplifications. And this is the reason for which when you put things here, the sine of the arctangent will give exactly what you want. How much time do I have? Finished? Ah, okay. No. So, well, that's it. So maybe tomorrow we will briefly discuss the decay of Schrödinger since I promised, and we will try to prove that all functions are S-harmonic or S-caloric or whatever. Let's see if we manage to stay in time. Sorry for the delay.